Andy was married to her high school sweetheart, Tim Talbot, on August 14th, 1971, in Arvada, Colorado. Now, I say high school sweetheart, but I learned this week, the story goes like this. Sandy dumped Tim during the summer to keep her options open, and then she dated him again when they got back to school, which led to them getting married after graduation. Sandy and Tim have two children, Tanya, who is married to Matt, Timothy Jr., who is married to Teresa. Sandy has two grandchildren, Katrina and Andrew, and one step-grandson, Anthony. Sandy also has one great-grandchild, Lila, who will be three in January. Sandy loved her family, and they never wondered what she thought. Sandy was upfront, straightforward, and also very, very detailed. So much so, she already had songs picked out. She burned CDs, mailed them to her children of what she wanted at her funeral. To one of those songs, we turn. And I think it captures Sandy quite well. It's a little upbeat, but it'll direct us in the right way. Psalms 121. I lift my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? My help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. And remembering Sandy, I'm mindful of a few things. It really only took me a few moments when I met Sandy for the first time that I knew I had met my equal in love of God's word. She devoured God's word consistently, and she wanted it more and more. Matter of fact, when we started our Disciple Makers class, she was front and center and did not miss one Wednesday night, simply because it was time for her to do her favorite thing, study God's word. One of the final conversations we had, I'm going to cherish for the rest of my life. One Sunday, she stopped me before our gathering, and she said, "I need to talk to you afterwards." Now, if you know Sandy, that can mean a lot of things. So after the message, I went directly to her, and I asked her what she needed. And then she proceeded to encourage me. She said, "I am so thankful that every time I come to church, I know that I am going to hear God's word preached. You preach God's word every Sunday, and don't you dare stop." I will treasure those words for the rest of my life. I also loved, and perhaps you did too, her quirky ways. In spending time with the family, I was shown, believe it or not, a few Snapchats that put on display Sandy's goofy side. You should see them. They're quite hilarious. She also loved camping and playing games. She actually taught my family and my kids how to play Skippo, but I hear her favorite with her family was hand and foot. Sandy hated cats, but she loved Itzy, her new little dog. Sandy actually stayed rather active. By the most surprising thing that I ever learned about Sandy Talbot, she stayed active by line dancing. Yes, she stayed active by line dancing. Sandy had so many strong traits. This is really clearly seen in the fact that she started her own business back in the 80s, and that business was very successful. Sandy saw something, and she went after it with great diligence. She worked hard, but in working hard, she never missed a moment to stop everything and help out other work associates, even as she did when she was on vacation, as the family was telling me a few days ago. Of course, one cannot spend any amount of time with Sandy and not hear and see her love of gadgets. She always was up to date on the latest iPads, Apple Watch, the newest pencil for the iPad. Sandy had a lot of strong traits. But one that is most encouraging to us all is that Sandy loved the church. Her and Tim quickly got involved here at Light in the Desert Church. They were in the trenches with us. They were not afraid to dive in head first. Tim, I can still see Sandy's hair on crazy hair night when we had kids camp and a million ponytails. And like she did here, she did everywhere she attended. You know what I also learned this week? That Sandy was involved with a puppet ministry many years ago. As I sat with the family, they recalled how often students were in her home and how often they were investing into others. Sandy loved the church. Sandy loved Light in the Desert Church. Sandy loved my kiddos. And she loved all of you that are joining us today. Many of you, whether you're in person or in Zoom, you felt that same sense of love from her. Sandy's going to be deeply missed. Let's pray. Lord, as we take just a few moments and remember Sandy, Lord, in doing that, we rejoice at what you did in her life. One of the things that was so evident about the life that she lived is that she loved you beyond all other things. So, Father, as we reflect and as we consider and think about the life she lived, it draws us upward. It draws us towards you, and we can rejoice that we got a chance to know her, that we got a chance to know someone who loved you beyond measure. Father, we ask that you would end that remembering, that you would get us comfort. As we approach the Christmas season, make us mindful that your Son identifies and knows our pain. May the Talbot family understand that you know their pain. And perhaps in their remembering, would that lift their spirits? Father, it is in your holy and precious name that we pray. Amen. First Thessalonians 4, verses 13 through 18. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Amen. How do you honor a person? Well, by appreciating who they were. And spending time with the family this week, this precious, precious family. And spending time with them this week, over and over again. There are a few common things that came up. One was Sandy was up front and would tell you what was on her mind. Secondly, she was most upfront in her love for Jesus. Well, this would be a great pattern for us to follow with our remaining time. Let's start by being upfront. This hurts. Sandy's death is going to sting for a while. There is no canned, cold response that can heal our broken hearts. It hurts, and we will mourn. But can I be upfront again? Mourning is not bad, and it is a helpful way to reflect. You see, mourning and reflecting hold hands in times of death, and they should remain close friends throughout our lives. These two great friends, mourning and reflecting, if I'm to be upfront, is what I intend to do today. I want to cause us to reflect as we mourn. Perhaps this very moment, whether you're in person or on Zoom, you find yourself emotionally drained. Hold on. Healing is coming. How is this? Well, let's start with mourning. The great preacher in Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verses 1 through 4 states this: it is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting. He also says that the heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in the house of pleasure. Well, this is because mourning, particularly in death, causes one to focus on the fragileness of life, to readjust our priorities, and certainly to wonder about what is next. This is why Ecclesiastes tells us that the day of death is better than the day of birth. It is in mourning death that often causes us to stop and consider our own lives. Death confronts us. Death is upfront with us. It's particularly upfront with us in the frailness of our lives. You see, mourning forces us to reflect. Death reminds us that life is messy and not always perfect. Why did Sandy tastes such a sudden death? Why is she gone? Why now? Honestly, like I already said, I don't think any of you want me to give a cold, automated response when you hurt so bad. They just don't seem to bring the necessary comfort that we all so desperately want. Sandy's death leaves a bad taste in our mouth. We don't like it. But what I can say, along with the preacher of Ecclesiastes, is that sorrow is better than laughter. For by sadness of face, the heart is made glad. How is the heart made glad with sadness? Well, Sandy's death that makes you, makes me mourn, could be the great mentor that causes you to be diligent, to become sober, to love more, to be generous, or become humble. If her death brings this about, gladness could certainly result. But what about reflection? How and what should we reflect on? Well, Sandy sets a really good course for us here. This is where I can take her lead and be upfront about Jesus. One thing that I have learned from the events over the past few days is that death is certain. It does not wait for a convenient moment to visit us. Death does not play favorites. It is not biased. It is not concerned with how good you are or how bad you are, nor does it care about your feelings. It visits us all. And sure, you may not like its company, but it does not change the unavoidable fact it will come. It comes sudden and without warning. As I reflected, and I'm sure as you have reflected over the last few days, I've searched my own heart, asking that deep question, am I ready for that day? And it makes me look out at you, whether you're in person or on Zoom, and ask the same thing. Are you ready for that day? 2 Corinthians 15, verses 54 through 57 says this: death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, the sting of death is sin. But notice in the text that it mentions victory. But let's be clear here. It is only through our Lord Jesus Christ whom Sandy loved. You might actually find it interesting that celebration is possible with such a tragedy as this. Sandy's death was untimely. And let's be honest, that hurts. And yes, mourning, sadness, frustration are real in times like this. But we can celebrate. Do you hear the joy in those verses? That death, which visits us all, can be swallowed up. Death can be overcome. And death could possibly not have the final say in your life. As we mourn this day, let it be clear that death, as ugly and devastating as it is, has been defeated in Christ. The scriptures tell us that death is to be feared only when our sin has not been confessed and our hearts have not been turned towards Christ. I suppose the best question I can pose as I reflect on the death of Sandy is this, and I can almost hear her. I can almost see her pointing and asking it as well. When death comes knocking on your door, can you fling the door open and with confidence like Sandy did say, bring it on? Victory is mine through Christ. You see, it's through Christ that we celebrate today. 1 Peter 2:24 tells us that he, Jesus himself, bore our sins in his body on that tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. His death brings our joy in our death. Yes, today is a celebration of sorts because Sandy believed and trusted that truth. And it was the family's desire that we push that truth forward today. My deepest prayer for you is that when your day comes, and don't worry, it will come, and you take that final breath, that your life will be hidden in Christ. I pray that death would not have the final say in your life, that death, as Paul said, would be gain for you. For by grace, we are saved through faith. Would you today, as Sandy did many, many years ago, place a deep trust in Christ for the forgiveness of your sin? Would you run to him, turning away from all other trust, and grab his arm and follow him? The best way to honor Sandy is in faith, embrace Christ's sacrifice as yours. Turn from your sin, turn from your self-effort, turn from your past mistakes, because we all have many, and run to God through Christ. I suspect that's what Sandy would appreciate most. Let's pray. Father God, it is not an easy task to mourn the loss of people we love. Father, matter of fact, if we were to be upfront and honest, we hurt. It's hard for us to make sense of such an untimely death as Sandy Talbot. Father, it seemingly doesn't make a lot of sense to us. It's hard for us to grab a hold of. It's hard for us to fully comprehend. But Lord, what I think we should be mindful of and what this moment does for us can be joyous. If it causes us, as we reflect on the life that Sandy lived, if it causes us to be more intimate with you, if it causes us to place our trust and our faith in you, we can rejoice. Father, we know, as your scripture tells us, that you have answered our prayers. Father, we're honest. It's not as we wanted it, but Lord, you answered our prayers to heal Sandy. She is healed in a sense that is beyond what we can imagine. And we can rejoice today because she is well. And Father, we ask that in these moments that you would push us to trust and understand you more. But Lord, we're going to need your help. As the psalmist cries out in Psalms 121, I look up to the hills, where does my help come from? Father, we're going to need your help. Would you walk with the Talbot family? Would you look after them? Would you give them strength? And would you give them the ability to mourn properly, to come to your word like Sandy did so frequently? Father, and to spend time in your presence. Father, we ask that you would help us as a church. Would you help all of Sandy's friends and work associates? As 2020 has been a very difficult year, we ask for your presence, we ask for your comfort, and Father, we beg and plead that people, us, would mourn and reflect. That Father, in the life of Sandy, we would see your hand. And Father, in the life of Sandy, that we would reflect on our lives and give ourselves fully to you. So Father, it is in your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Well, this concludes our time of remembering Sandy. In lieu of flowers or cards, the family has asked that we give to our Lottie Moon Christmas offering. This is a special offering that 100% of what we take in will go to international mission work. You didn't have to spend much time with Sandy to realize that she loved the gospel and she would want everybody to hear it. It would be such an honor for all of us to give to the gospel being spread to the entire world in her memory. You can give in person today by dropping it in the offering plate as you head out there in the foyer, or you can give online. There's a link on our website from the home page. There's also a link on our Facebook page that'll take you directly to that offering. The family just wanted me to make sure that you were aware of that, and that would be something that would honor Sandy and they would be very appreciative of. Thank you again for being here in person or being with us online. Your presence supports the Talbot family. Would you continue to be in prayer for them? You're dismissed.